What is up, everyone? My name is Will Holdren. I am the host of the Will Power Podcast. Today we have an amazing guest. I'm so honored and blessed to have him on here with us. And his name is Rio Osorio. And Rio is an amazing, amazing entrepreneur. He's a relationship architect. He's actually the founder of Alpha Army. And in fact, they have about 1 million followers on Instagram, which is super impressive. They're helping a lot of people achieve financial freedom in their own lives. So with that being said, Rio, thank you so much for joining me today.
Yeah, thanks for having me, dude. Appreciate it.
Course, man, my pleasure. And so to start off, I kind of want to go into your childhood a little bit. So kind of talk to me through like your childhood, what it was like, and how it helped you become who you are today.
Yeah, so I grew up, I'm from Arizona originally. I live in Phoenix area now, but I'm from a small copper mining town. So, growing up, all my family's blue collar, still to this day, all of them are blue collar, still work in the mines. So, yeah, it was one of those things where it's like, I had one friend that was kind of like the friend that had all the money in my very small town of about, probably at the time, probably around 7,000, 8,000 people. And it was one of those things where I would go to their house and it was like, this is different than my house. This is different than what I see around me every day. Down, like literally down to the smells. Like it smelled different. It smelled nice. And I'm just like, okay, I want this. This is what I want. So I knew from a very young age that, maybe there was something more out there than what I was currently experiencing in my family. And, it was one of those things where, from a very early age, I knew that, and I would just always be hustling different things. Always, I talked to a friend of mine from high school. I don't know, it's probably a year ago now, but he's like, dude, you were always like hustling stuff. I didn't even realize it at the time, but he was like, yeah, you were always hustling some different, trying to sell something. So yeah, I mean, I knew. I get, or I guess I didn't even know, but I was working, on these steps from a very young age. And I got my now ex-wife got pregnant very early on. I was literally just turned 18. So I had my first daughter when I was 18. And, at the time I had to do what I had to do. So I did what everybody did in my town. I went to work in the mines. And not to say it was bad. I strongly believe I got my work ethic from that. And, I couldn't be more proud of that because after you go through an experience like that, working in the mines, it's like anything after that is easy. And that's the way I see it. I may have bad days or certain things that happen, in business, but it's just like, I mean, come on. In reality, this is easy. I could be, back in the mines doing the same thing that I was doing before. So yeah, I did that. My first stint with that, I did that for a couple of years, and I still had this drive in me. I wanted to do something else and or do something more, make more money, have more impact. And it was always like I wanted to own my own business. So when I was around 21 years old, I bought my first business. It was a FedEx route. So I don't know if FedEx Ground, you own your own route. So I had a specific area that was mine, and at the time, which it really doesn't seem like much now, but at the time I was around 21 years old, it was $30,000 to buy the route and the truck that came along with it, the box truck. And I didn't have $30,000, so it was like, how do I do this? And that was kind of my first experience. Kind of grown-up experience, if you will. I had to kind of figure out going to the bank, writing a business loan, doing all these things that I had zero idea to do, and there was no real internet back then. So I hadn't really picked up yet, so I had to figure all this stuff out, reading books. I did it. I got the loan. I did that for a few years, and it was a really cool experience, learning all those things. And through just normal events in life. Like I said, I was very young when I had my first child, got married very young. When I was around 24 years old, that marriage ended. Being young, not knowing how to go through a lot of these things. Kind of everything went to shit at the time, and lost my business, filed bankruptcy, you know, just a whirlwind of stuff, you know, and things that I had to go through. And, you know, when that happens, it's like, okay, what do I do now? Well, I went back to mining. So, you know, that was kind of my safety zone, you know, spent some more time there, some years there, and just always kind of working on little hustles. And over time, I learned that, I guess my real skill set was, I was a creative guy, and not understanding what that meant yet. You know, it took me a few years, and then I realized it was marketing. That was kind of my thing. That was my passion. That's what I liked. I just didn't have a name for it at the time. So, you know, through time, I started some marketing agencies, some worked, some failed. And yeah, I mean, that's kind of up into maybe 6-7 years ago.
Gotcha. Well, that's definitely a fascinating background for you. There's a couple of things I definitely want to touch on. So one, you're from a small town, obviously people are very blue collar, just like you're talking about, but you had like these really big dreams. Even at 21, like you said, you bought that first FedEx route for $30,000, which to a lot of people around you, I'm sure they're thinking like, what is this guy doing? Like, he's out of his mind. Like, this isn't what you do. Stick to doing the 9-to-5 thing, stick to working in the mines. And it's such a different conversation, because you can't tell big dreams to small-minded people, because that's how you crush dreams. And so many people around me have kind of experienced that. I've seen it where you tell the wrong person your dream, and then boom, they crush it, because they don't understand kind of like what's in your mind and what you really want to do with that. So just pausing at that moment in your life, when you first purchased that FedEx route, like, what were the conversations going on around you? Like, were they calling you crazy for doing that? And how did you kind of overcome those just mental objections and still just push through, even though the ones closest to you were the ones telling you, you know, maybe this is not a good idea?
Yeah. So no, I mean, you're exactly right. That's exactly the conversations, you know, and again, for me, or at least now as a dad myself, it's like, I understand those conversations coming from my family, coming from my parents, that it was more of a safety thing. They, you know, they want to make sure their son is safe. It wasn't coming out of a bad place. You know, they were, the only thing that they can work off of is the current operating system that they have. And that's how they grew up, and that's what you do. But I'm reading this book right now. It's called The War of Art by Stephen Pressfield. And it's funny, this morning I was listening to it on the drive to the office, and it talks about resistance. And that's kind of, in a sense, what that is. And, you know, it talks about resistance being basically like the dream stealer. Like, how many dreams has resistance stolen? Because you get a little bit of resistance, and how many people have given up or failed, or your parents said it's not a good idea, or, you know, your friend from, you know, 5 years ago, you know, says you think you're too good, or whatever it is, all these different things that I've been through, and a lot of people in my position have been through. And it's that resistance that is a dream stealer. And, you know, I think as you go throughout life, put it this way. So a lot of the people on my team are younger guys, just like you. You know, we got a lot of 20 somethings on our sales team. And I see some stuff, you know, in some of my more personal relationships with some of them, where some, they get a little resistance on something, and it's just melting them. It's like so hard, like they're never going to get through it. The world is ending. Everything's so bad. And I'm sitting there kind of just like, dude, this is nothing. Like, you know, and that's kind of what the resistance over time does. It builds up that resilience so that you can handle those things. And, you know, like I said, whereas I've got some guys 23 years old, and, you know, they're a little resistance, everything is so hard. I'm just sitting there like, dude, this is nothing. Just, you know, if this is hard, give it a couple of weeks and it'll be gone. And, you know, it's kind of like that saying, this too shall pass. It's like, hey, if things are hard, if things are going really bad in your life or whatever, it's like, this too shall pass. But conversely, the same thing. Hey, are things really good? Are things going so great in your life? Well, guess what? This too shall pass. And, you know, that's just the ebbs and flows of life and the things you go through. But over time, those things build resistance. And over time, you also work towards kind of flatlining those in a sense, where it's not so much high highs and low lows. It's more just kind of cruising along upwards, and you know, and that kind of saves your mindset and all the things that you got to go through as an entrepreneur.
Yeah.
To keep you on the steadfast.
Yep, and that's well said. And that's exactly what it is. It's just a one big emotional roller coaster, right? So it's just going to be a lot of ups and downs. And you know, being a younger person as well, I know a lot of people listen to this podcast. One of the things I learned is that you just got to be careful, like, who you're listening to.
Yeah,
right? You won't want to trade places with the person that's giving you advice. They're not living the dreams, and you know, maybe it's not the best advice that you should actually be listening to. And that helps a lot, you know, when you're comparing to other people, because early on, a lot of people don't have those growth-minded people around, those entrepreneurs that they need to be around. That's their actual tribe. They got their friends that are, you know, drinking all the time and doing all this other stuff that's kind of distracting them, right? Yeah. So just on that line, just being careful of who you're actually listening to going down the road. Definitely. And so after that, in your journey, obviously you did that. And then a couple years later, you actually got divorced. Like, you got a kid on the way and you're bankrupt, right? So that is like the lowest of lows, like, that you could have in life. So I just want to know, like, what was going through your mind at that point? And what did you decide to do to actually get yourself off the ground again, to kind of just give it another go at it, knowing that you have big dreams still you want to go after and accomplish?
Yeah, I mean, back then, again, I was at that time, I was around 24. So it kind of goes back to what we were just saying. At that time, that was kind of really my first big experience with resistance, with things not going right. Yeah. So yeah, it was very hard for me, very difficult. It honestly took me a few years to kind of work through that and get through those things and kind of see the light of day again. And you know, I don't know as though there was necessarily any one thing that was like, you know, I got to keep going, I got to continue. I think honestly, it was just something that was still just deep in me that I just knew that I had to continue, I had to keep going. And there was just these, you know, deep things within that was like, you know, my real dad wasn't around when I was young. I mean, he basically bounced. And it was one of those things in life where it's like, you know, you see a lot of people, it's like, oh, my dad wasn't around, my mom wasn't around, this happened, my dad beat me, this whatever. And it's like, they're either going to turn into that same thing and continue that legacy, or they're going to change it. And for me, it was like, no, my dad wasn't around. You know, I had three, by the time I was 24, I had three daughters, and wow. I'm just like, I am going to be around. I am going to be a good dad. I am going to figure this out. And whether it was that experience when I was young and carrying that into other parts of my life, it was just always like, okay, I messed up here, or this didn't work out, but I'm going to figure it out. I'm going to keep going. I'm going to put in my time. I'm going to put in the reps so that I can continue to get better and evolve and, you know, more so figure out who I am as an entrepreneur. And
right.
Honestly, that was a long journey. I didn't know. I tried so many different things, as you hear a lot. And, you know, it took me a long time to really figure out that it was marketing. And then it was like, okay, what does that mean? Like,
right.
What do I do? And my first real experience marketing was a medical dental marketing agency. And, you know, that lasted around a year. And I'm just like, this sucks. It is not this. Like, I am more creative. I want to be able to use that creativity. And I really couldn't do it there. And shortly after that, that's when I kind of discovered like social media marketing. And that's where I kind of found myself for a while and dug into that and was able to build some decent businesses and work with some pretty cool people that I can now call friends and mentors of mine. And yeah, so.
Yeah. So what I love about that is you definitely took all the excuses off the table for entrepreneurs and just time management skills, because you had three daughters at 24, right? Help them like grow them up on their own. And you're also going out there starting up businesses. So like, how did you find time to work on these businesses and get them off the ground with three daughters and still being a dad and still do all this other stuff on your own? Like, how would you figure out the whole time management part of that?
So, I mean, definitely not going to act like I had that on lock. I absolutely didn't. That took a long time to really hone in on that. I was just more so a hustler. I just went after it. And, you know, unfortunately at the time when I went through the divorce, I was just basically a weekend dad. So during the week, you know, I grind it all week. And, you know, even on the weekend sometimes. But it was just one of those things that took me a long time. And, you know, I'm remarried now. I have a total of 8 kids. Awesome. Five are my biological, and then my wife had 3 in her previous marriage as well. And then awesome. We had 2 together. And, you know, it's one of those, it's just learning over time, getting better over time. And, you know, as I kind of looked back on how it was for my first 3 daughters, and how I was, and, you know, was I present? I really wasn't that much, because I was just out there hustling. And I wanted that to be different with my kids, with my wife now. And I just kind of had to reprioritize things, you know, like, what is most important to me? Like, first, I don't ever wish divorce on anybody. So I don't ever want to go through that again. So it's like, I need to prioritize, you know, my family, and make sure that foundation is there before I'm going out and doing all the other things I need to do. And, you know, thankfully I have a badass wife, and she's nothing like me, but she gets me, and she trusts me fully, and she puts all her faith in me. And, you know, I'm just trying not to let her down.
That's awesome. I love that, because a lot of entrepreneurs get their values kind of mixed up. And like you said, it's not all about the money. Family is a huge part of it, if not the most important part of it. So I'm glad you brought that up. Yeah. So later in your journey, obviously started Alpha Army. So talk to me about what drove you to start Alpha Army and what you guys actually do over there at Alpha Army.
Yeah. So, oh man, this was, I think just about 3 years ago.
Okay.
I had, after marketing, basically I jumped into, like, e-commerce was getting big, and I'm like, I don't know if you know, like, e-com automation, Amazon automation, all that. I'm sure you've heard of it.
Heard of that stuff, yeah.
So, you know, I had a little bit of money to invest at the time. So I invested in Amazon automation store. I did it. It did really well, very fast. And it was one of those things where I'm like, okay, I like this. I like how easy it is. But I don't want to be paying this management company to run my stuff. I want to run this whole business. So I started, I partnered up with a couple people. We started our own management company. I had a big warehouse in Tempe, Arizona. I set it up like it was a cool spot. Like it was the spot to be. If you walked in, you're like, dude, this place is dope. And what happened was we were just doing our thing, running that, had no thoughts of really doing anything else at the time. But through a relationship that I had, a guy called us up and was just like, hey, I've got a group of these guys. They're slinging life insurance. There's about 50 of them, but they're just kind of lost. A lot of them making some dumb decisions, not, you know, being very smart. They just need some mentorship and a place to be. And that friend of mine was in Texas, so he couldn't really do anything about it. And I'm like, bring them over. Let's see what we can do. And, you know, at the time I had some pretty dope cars out front too. We had a Rolls Royce, had a McLaren out there. It was just the spot, dude. And these guys rolled up, 19, 20 year olds, and instantly were sold, like, dude, we want to be here. This is the spot. And basically came in. We kind of at first created kind of a little more so like, if you're going to use my space and use it for, you know, promoting to recruit and do all these things, you're just going to pay us, you know, whatever. I don't even remember what it was. And, you know, very shortly, like, it started turning into some real money. So I'm like, again, as a businessman, I'm like, okay, I want to dig more into this. What does this mean? How do we build a business out of it? And from there, I got into the life insurance game, and, awesome. With he's still my partner this day, Daniel Giles, and he would be a good one for you to talk to as well. I'll set you up. But anyways, at the time, I think 20 years old, I mean, this kid was just one of the best salesmen that I've ever seen. Like, and that young, I'm just like, this kid is sharp. So let's figure out how we can turn this into a real thing. We started very shortly getting on the radar of some big organizations, because of how much we were selling, we were crushing it. And then it was it was probably just under a year into that, we had a solar company approach us, and they were like, you know, we see what you guys are doing. We see how you guys are recruiting. You got to have all these guys. We want to recruit you guys to come sell solar in California with us, and we'll pay you $100,000. So at the time, even though we were doing really well, we were selling life insurance over the phone. And at the time we were having some issues with that, like regulations and certain things we weren't supposed to be doing. Again, I was new to the industry, so I was just figuring stuff out. And I'm just like, screw it, let's do it. So we dropped everything. I moved those guys out to California, started doing that for about 4 months, and it was cool. We were making money, but the company we were working with wasn't really coming through on the things they said. So I had a partnership with a guy, actually where I'm at now, already in, we were doing life insurance before. This is Medicare, a little bit different thing. Okay. So, but his whole background is the door-to-door space. And, you know, I've never done that ever. So when we were having some of these setbacks, I was basically like, Daniel, let's take everybody back to Arizona. Let's just partner up with Dan. Let's merge this whole thing together. He has the background in door to door, and let's turn this thing up. So that's kind of how we got where we are now. And that was kind of, so we had Alpha Army, but it was Alpha Sales Group originally, and then we changed it to Alpha Army. So we had it that whole time with the life insurance, and we just kind of carried it on. But now we've just been putting more time and effort into it. And that's really kind of our recruiting arm of what we do. That's how we recruit new sales guys to come in. And we currently sell solar, roofing, and we're licensed public adjusters. So home services space, that's where we're at. And we love it. I mean, it's a great space to be in. Roofing and solar are just massive industries right now. They're getting a lot of attention, a lot of like private equity eyes and venture capital eyes looking at the industry. So, you know, we're working on some big potential mergers right now, so that we'll be able to sell in the next couple of years.
Gotcha. So that's awesome. Okay. So you guys are basically a sales group, and, you know, sales make the world go around. I think it's one of the best skills that anyone out there can learn, especially at a young age, jump in with some kind of business, whatever it is, and learn how to sell. Cause that's something you can take with you for the rest of your entire life.
Exactly.
So how big is your team right now? And, you know, like, what are you trying to grow it to? Like, when you're recruiting, and how are you going about recruiting methods? Cause obviously a lot of people want to do that and know how to do that well. So how are you guys going about that?
Sure. So currently we have about 60 employees, and growing. So as of right now, we're just in the Phoenix area. We just started a team down in Tucson, Arizona. If you're familiar, it's another great market. If this merger goes through that we're working on, that will instantly put us in five states. So at that time, I mean, we'll just turn up recruiting. I mean, we'll probably, the goal there would probably be 200 to 300 sales people out there slinging all the different products. So in terms of recruiting, when these guys came into my warehouse, I had never even thought about anything like that. I didn't really know what it looks like, but I'm a smart guy, and I analyze everything. Like, why are they here? Why is this working? Like, down to like, okay, these guys came into my warehouse and it obviously looks cool. That's what's drawing them in. So I use those things, you know, I use my creative to leverage those things. And it's just like, okay, what's going on right now? What's hot? What's cool? And I try just to build cool environments. You're on the computer here, so I can't really spin you around, but even this office, this is one of our podcast studios. Yep. And, you know, it's just all about creating cool environments and then using social media to, you know, to blast that out there. And then we, you know, thankfully we have some pretty dope players on our team that, and ownership that are, you know, killers at what they do, great trainers, great salesmen. And, you know, that's helped us attract more people over time. And right now we're really looking to kind of double down on that and really start pushing more ads and things like that on social media, not just organic.
That's awesome. Yeah. So a lot of that recruiting is you guys are attracting them to you rather than you guys are going out like chasing people left and right. They're just coming to you because, like you said, you guys have an environment. Yeah. You guys got the dope setup. So everything is just kind of falling in place and they're just coming out, finding you guys in a good environment.
Yeah. And you know, too, like I'm not like a guy that's like, I've never been the one that's like, you know, I want everybody to, you know, I want to be in the spotlight necessarily, but I'm also a marketer and I know what works. So I do what I got to do. But recently I'm just like, you know what? I need to double down. I know what works. I need to get myself out there more, but I also have kind of seen, you know, the rise of all these podcasts happening. So I'm like, okay, if we start a podcast and then how can we leverage that to continue to grow? So what we're doing right now is strategically, finding guests for the podcast. Say specifically right now, we do a lot of real estate people. Well, you know, we're bringing them in. It's like, cool, let's do the podcast. Everybody feels cool. Let's, you know, content. We'll share the content, help you guys out. But that's our way of also building that relationship now. And it's like, hey, how can we help each other out further? Like, you guys are in real estate. People have homes and, you know, when you're selling the real estate, that's homes. That's where we want to put our products. How can we work together, you know, to give each other referrals and, you know, so that we can all make more money together. And it's been working really well. And I really like the model and we're just scaling that up right now.
Yeah. I love that. Podcasts are honestly like one of the best things out there that anyone can do. One, because it does not cost a lot of money to get something up and running. And a network that you can grow just to meet people by online, like what we're doing right here, it's insane. You know what I mean? So like you got to be out there and take advantage of it. Here you are like a top tier marketer, right? And still use that same strategy because it works.
It does. And you know, for me, relationships are everything. Like I learned that probably 6 years ago when I found my first mentor, John Malott, and relationships are everything. And I'm like, there's really no better way to build a relationship than, you know, sitting and in our case, sitting on a couch, shooting a podcast and just shooting the shit with somebody and, you know, digging in. And I just feel like that's a way to build really powerful relationships. And those relationships, whether, you know, whether we can do something today and make some money together today, or whether it's 6 months, a year from now, you're like, oh yeah, he was on my podcast. We have a relationship. Here's something that would fit perfectly. Let's hit him up and, you know, we can make some money together, do something together.
Yeah. I mean, it's the old adage, your network is your net worth, right? And it's so true. Like at the end of the day,
It's
amazing. So before we run out of time, just a couple more questions for you. So move forward in your business. Now you got a big merger coming. Hopefully it goes through, right? So on top of that, what are some other big goals that you hope to get accomplished like in the next couple of years with you personally or just you and your business?
Yeah, so it's definitely an exit. That's the big play. That's the big, not that I would necessarily retire on that because I love to work and I'm still young enough that I just love deals. I love doing deals. And but I mean, that's how, you know, that's how wealthy people get wealthy. I mean, buying, selling businesses. I mean, it's the way to go. So that's our big plan right now is, you know, making a big push for getting everything structured properly, whether this merger happens or not. Regardless, we're still on the same track, making sure everything's set up and just really scaling so that when it's time to sell, we're ready to go and we can, you know, make as much as possible.
What's your time frame on that? Do you have any time frame in mind for that?
2026.
2026. That's awesome. That's awesome. So a couple years in advance. Yeah. That's very cool.
Yeah, that's the goal, man. And I would encourage anybody, especially young, like just recently, you know, I got in the room with some guys that are, I mean, worth hundreds of millions of dollars. And you know, it goes back to the relationships and it like I'm sitting in these rooms just like, dude, like I'm so out of my league right now. But at the same time, I'm just building relationships and these guys are just cool. We're just talking, doing this stuff. And what I'm getting at is like, never count yourself out. Like, and you're just one relationship away from something big happening. And what I also realized, because, you know, I did bring one of my partners with me. on one of these meetings, 23 years old. Like, these guys are like in their late 50s, 60s, some even 70s, but they still love doing deals. And it's like, they love these young guys. They love them. They just love shooting the shit with them, talking about it. Maybe it reminds of when they were young, whatever it is. But, you know, so don't ever count your youth against yourself. I mean, there's tons of relationships out there. And, you know, you young guys, you're in the mix. You're seeing what's going on. You're seeing what's hot. You're seeing probably a lot more of the possibilities that are out there that they may not be seeing that you could bring to the table. And, you know, just that one relationship right there, I was able to get on a call with a guy that we're putting together, you know, a massive potential deal where they're going to raise about $75 million for us. So,
wow,
nothing has gone through. Nothing's for sure. But to me, it's just about the opportunity. And maybe this one doesn't work out. But as long as I, you know, I keep doing those things, and I'm a lot older than you, man, I'm 42, but
still young.
One of them is going to happen. You know, one of them is going to happen if you just keep going, and something big that can just completely change your life forever, even at your age, it's out there waiting for you. You just got to go get it.
That's it. I love it, man. That's very well said. Very well said. So after that, what's your favorite business book or entrepreneurship book that you've read or currently reading, I guess?
Currently reading, so I'm reading, like I said earlier, a couple books by Stephen Pressfield right now. So the first one, or the one I'm on right now, is the War of Art, not the Art of War, the War of Art. Very great book. The one I just got finished with, and, you know, for those of you who don't like to read, it's a super short book. I do the audio version, and it was like 2 hours, not very long, but it's called Turning Pro by Stephen Pressfield. Again, great book. And it's just talking about, you know, turning from an amateur to a pro. Most people go throughout their lives, you know, trying all these different things and never becoming a pro at anything. And it's about, you know, settling down, focusing on one thing, becoming a pro at that, and using that, leveraging that to build your bank account. And, you know, for me, I do a lot of different things. We only talked about a couple of them here. I have other businesses as well. And the only reason I'm able to do that now is because I focused on one thing first, was able to make some money. And then that allowed me to invest into other things, build a strong team around me of people that are, you know, that can do all the things that I'm not good at or I don't want to do. Right. And so that's important. So yeah, Turning Pro and The War of Art.
Awesome. Appreciate that. And then before we hop off, how can people reach out to you and find you if they want to get in contact with you or find your business?
Yeah, I mean, the best place would be Instagram. That's probably where I am the most. And that is at Rio Osorio. It's just my first and last name, just R-I-O-O-S-O-R-I-O. Yeah.
Awesome. All right, guys, there you have it. Rio Osorio, thank you so much for joining me today.
Right on, brother. Appreciate it.